Amen, amen. Isn't it wonderful to know that God walks with us? God talks with us. God tells us that we are His own. Welcome, welcome once again to the time of reflection, coming to you here from the Students of Faith Temple, Assemblies of God here in Princess Street, Montego Bay, Jamaica. I want to welcome you. My name is Reverend Peter Burnett. I am the president of Send the Light Ministry and Emmanuel Caribbean University. And I get to sit in today for my wonderful elder brother in the Lord and Bishop Conrad Pitkin. Thank God for him being the senior pastor here at Faith Temple Assembly of God. Sitting in here today is my honor. And I just want you to know that we are going to have a wonderful time together. We're going to spend some time praying. We're going to read the scripture together. I have a word, a message I want to share with you. And we want to encourage you, those of you on Facebook, those of you on YouTube, want to welcome you first of all. And then I want to encourage you to like and share the information about this channel. If you're on Facebook, you know, you can copy and paste it in WhatsApp or other groups. You can create a watch group with others here during the midday. And of course, as you see on your screen, there is the website for Faith Temple, Assemblies of God, faithtempleaog.org. You can find out about them, about their services, and about how you can be in touch with them. Those of you on Cornwall Communication here in Montego Bay and across Jamaica and the western part of the nation, welcome as well. Welcome. You're on 253. Why don't you let others know? One of the things that we are wanting to do is to grow this time of reflection during the midday hour. You have different speakers, different pastors that come on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. On Wednesdays at 1 o'clock, all the other time at noon, we just stop in the day, lift up our eyes to the hills, and reflect upon the Lord our God. On the screen, let's look at the phone numbers. You can call in right during the program. Call here at 876-952-3436 or 876-979-6856. Call in. If you don't get someone, call again. Leave a message any hour of the day, anytime. There's a prayer ministry here in this church that is willing to pray for your needs, and they encourage you to call. If you're on YouTube, leave a message. Facebook, leave a message. We want to pray with you, and we want to lift up the needs that you have before the Lord, because our God is an everlasting, ever-present, almighty and powerful God, and He's able to do far exceeding abundantly above anything you could ever ask or need. Well, my brother, Dr. Lester Lewis, has been singing about God's goodness for a long time. He sings about the Word of God. He started out his singing ministry as a reggae gospel artist in the festival, in the Jamaican festival here, long before there were any of the popular reggae gospel artists. So let's join him today with his signature song, Every Time I Read My Bible. God bless you.
Stay right, Christ will be what? Forgiveness. The bright Christ will be justice. The bright Christ will be righteousness. The bright Christ will be fairness. And the bright Christ will be faithfulness. Clap your hands at the Lord and scream.
Every time I read my Bible, feel alright, alright. Every time I read my Bible, feel so nice. Yes, every time I read my Bible, I feel all.
persecute you, that he may be cheering up your Father which is in heaven. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. That is what my Bible says. Do likewise. Man, every time I read my Bible, I get a little knowledge.
Anniversary here of our independence in Jamaica, it is so important for us to recapture the importance of reading the Bible. It is from the Bible that we get hope. It is from the Bible that we get wisdom. It is from the Bible that our leaders will have revelation of the mind of God to fix the many problems that are ailing our nation today. It is in the Bible. Read the Bible. I believe if more of us was listening to the song of Lester Lewis and not just jiving to the beat, but we were listening to the word, we would be in a different place today. I'm going to ask you to pray with me right now. I want us to pray for Dr. Lewis and for his wife, Rose. You know, actually, Sister Rose was in the hospital and was sick, and Dr. Lewis has been sick, and we need to pray for them. Those men, that couple have sold their lives in ministering the word of God across our nation. Can you join me in prayer for Lester Lewis and his wife, Rose? Can you join me in prayer that God will reignite a love for the Bible, a love for the reading of the word of God to the heart of men? Will you join me in prayer that we get away from this ritualistic and this mystical view of the Bible, but we begin to have a hunger and a thirst for the word of God? Let us pray. Lord, we thank you in the name of your son, Jesus, that we get to meet here on this time of reflection. I thank you for those who are joining us, whatever media and mode by which they are joining. I give you praise that you are with them. You are with me. You are with us. And I pray as we lift our hearts in your presence that you will show forth and your Shekinah glory will come upon us wherever we are. Father, that your ears indeed, as you have promised, will be open to the things we lift up before you. We lift up specifically Dr. Lester Lewis and his wife, Rose, they who have sought to serve you and to sing your songs and to sing what you say and to highlight the word of God and to speak the word of God. Lord, we pray that now in the moment of their need, you'll bring healing to their bodies. You'll bring restoration to their lives. You will cause the seeds of righteousness that they have sown to begin to bear fruit. Fruit in their lives, fruit in their ministry, fruit in their family, fruit for them, Lord, wherever they are and the things that you have called them to do today. Strengthen them by the power of your mighty hand. Lord, we ask you to turn around every scheme, every plot, every attack of the enemy against their lives, against their ministry. Oh, Lord, strengthen them, I ask. You are the sovereign God. You are the glorious God. You are a faithful God. You are no man's debtor. Show yourself bold and strong and mighty on their behalf. Let their family members see. Let their neighbors see. Let their children see your divine grace and favor upon them. Lord, we pray that everything that is owed to them will come to them. Everything which have been stolen from them will be restored to them. Everything diverted from them will return. Lord, I not only pray for Lester and Rose, I pray for all those who are listening right now who are former pastors or who are pastors or deacons and former singers and Christian musicians and those who have given their lives, who have labored in the field of ministry, year after year, those who have walked up and down these hills, these valleys, these various areas in our nation, oh God, those who have taken taxis, those who have shown up at concert, shown up at rallies, shown up to preach the gospel across this land. I ask you, Lord, many of them today are in a moment of need. Many are in a moment of being tired. Many, oh Lord, are forgotten even by their children in the faith. I ask you to encourage them. I ask you to strengthen them. I ask you to come alongside them. I ask you, oh God, that you will stir in their heart a fresh fire. Stir in their heart, oh God, strength to run one more lap. Oh Lord, let the word of the Lord come alive to my brothers and my sisters who have served you. You said, Lord, you are no man's debtor. Show yourself mighty. Oh, bring healing to my brother and my sister. Bring encouragement to my brothers and my sister. Bring them to the mind and the heart of those that are spiritual children, that they will reach out to them. They will show them love. They will show them care, that you will move supernaturally on their behalf today. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I just want to pray for those of you that are discouraged today. I don't know what you're going through, but you're in a place of discouragement. You're in a place of feeling isolated. You're in a place where you feel those who should be supporting you are have turned their back on you. Those who should be loving on you is not loving on you. I want you to realize right now that God is filling that gap. Lord, I ask you to reveal yourself and fill the gap in the heart of every man and every woman. Listen to me. Father, you said in your word, when mother and father forsake us, Lord, there's a gap. There is a need. There's an emotional abandonment. But Lord, you said you will lift us up. You, oh God, will fill the gap. Remove that spirit of rejection from their shoulder. Let them call upon your name and show yourself strong. Let your grace and mercy come upon them, Lord, to fill every need. There'll be no abandonment, no rejection, no isolation, no fear. Fill up that gap, Lord, with the glory of your love. Fill up that gap with the wonder of your presence. Come on, open up your hands and just say, Lord, I receive. Lord, I receive your love to fill up every gap in my life. Lord, I receive your love where words of accusation, words of intimidation, words of lying, words, sometimes even some of our nicknames can have a sting to them, you know, and the enemy used those names to taunt us and to ridicule and to down talk and belittle. In the name of Jesus, we pull from your soul those arrows of the enemy. Lord, deliver your people from the arrows of hurt, of words, or of action of others that have wounded, have bruised, have caused the face to hang down in shame. Lord, I pray you reveal yourself to them, that they will know that you were there in the moment of rejection. You were there when the words were being thrown. You were there in the moment of the accusation. And Lord, I pray right now that you will cause them to hear your voice over the voice of the accuser. Let them hear your voice over the voice of those who will curse them, who will blast them, who will speak evil of them, who will seek to wound them in the spirit. May they hear your voice. Hallelujah. Open their spiritual ears now that they will hear the voice of the Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, I thank you to heal those that are brokenhearted. I just speak to you by the name of the Lord Jesus. Be healed. Those of you that are brokenhearted, those of you that are cast down, hope in the Lord. Come on, lift up your eyes to the Lord and say with me, say, Lord, I hope in you. Lord, I hope in you. And Lord, I thank you that as people will call upon you, who will put their trust in you, Lord, their homes are falling down around them. Things that they have trusted, jobs that they thought would be their security, have fallen down around them. Lord, reveal yourself as their hope. Show yourself mighty and in a supernatural way today. Lord, bless your people today. Oh, we lift up to you, oh God, the needs of this nation as Jamaica prepares for its independence in the 60th independence and prepare for the celebrations coming up in the next several months. We ask, Lord, that there will be a return of Jamaica to the Word of God. There will be a return of Christians to the love of the Word of God. We pray that the word, your words, your truth, your Bible will once again be looked to for principle, for guidance, for wisdom, for truth. Let your word, O God, be watched over. Let your word prevail above the word of every man, every woman, every leader, every gangster, every gang leader, every artist. Let your word, which is quick, which is powerful, which is sharper than any two-edged sword, let the word sweep across all 14 parishes. Lord, let there begin to be a wind of your spirit moving upon your word, bringing forth life into the heart of men. Oh Lord, let your word ignite the spirit of men. Let your word set on fire the conscience of men. Let your word renew the mind of men. Let your word bring men back to you. We believe you for a revival of the word of your Bible all over this nation. A love for your word. I pray for those listening who have become weary of your word. Come on, if you become weary of the scriptures, you become tired of the scriptures, I'm praying for you right now. I just pray for you. Say, Lord, cause me to fall in love with your word again. Lord, cause me to fall in love with your word all over again. Lord, your word we hide in our heart that we may not sin against you. Your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Your word is meat, and we eat it. It is sweet. It is wonderful. Your word we love and we delight in. Oh God, do this work in our hearts, not by might, not by power, but by your spirit. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. If the Lord is just touching your heart and you're being inspired to read the word, to get more deeper in God, why don't you call those numbers that is on the line? They're on your screen, 876-952-3436 or 876-979-6856. Or leave a comment on Facebook. Get in the Word. You know, right now you can download the Bible on your phone, various phone apps. You can have the Bible with you. You could be at work. You can have the Bible reading to you, even in the background while you work. In your car, you could put the Bible at home. Open up the windows. You know, if the guy down the street is playing his ungodly music, why don't you let the word spread? Let there be a love for your word. What about if you gather some of those young boys and young girls and young people around your neighborhood and just get together with them on a Sunday evening or a Friday evening and just read the Bible to them. Just read the word. Let's begin to stir up the word, because the word makes a difference. Amen. Amen. In fact, talking about the word, let's go right into the Bible. We're going to read from St. John chapter 6 from verse 1 to 14. I want to share as a word with you, a message that God knows the solution to our problem. And I want you to show you a couple of incidents in the Word of God to show us that God knows the solution to our problem. So in John chapter 6, from verse 1, after these things, meaning there were many other things that happened here in John chapter 5. There was a man that was healed at the pool of Bethesda. People were trying to kill Jesus, you could say, and to persecute him. He went up into the mountain, the Bible says. He went over the Sea of Galilee after a very, very hard week of preaching, you could say. Jesus wanted to get away. It's okay to get away, right? So Jesus got over onto the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Verse 2 of John 6 says, then a great multitude followed him because they saw his signs, which he performed on those who were diseased. So that was what was happening before. Healing a lot of people. Yeah, just imagine a mass crusade. A lot of people being healed over and over by Jesus. And Jesus, it says in verse 3, he went up on the mountain and he sat with his disciple. Now the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was near. Jesus lifted up his eyes and seeing a great multitude coming towards him, he said to Philip, where shall we buy bread that these may eat? But this he said to test them, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, saying, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have a little to eat. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, there is a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish. But what are they among so many? And then Jesus said, make the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down in number, about 5,000, and Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to the disciples, and then the disciples to those sitting down, and likewise of the fish, as much as they wanted. So when they were filled, he said to his disciples, gather up the fragments and that remain, so that nothing is lost. Therefore they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments of the 5 barley loaves, which were left over by those who had eaten. Then those men who had seen the sign that Jesus did said, this is truly the prophet who is come into the world. Amen. Do you believe that? I believe that. Jesus is truly the prophet who has come into the world. I believe it. Here we are in 2022. And the impact of Jesus, the works of Jesus, the miracles of Jesus, the signs and wonders, and the supernatural solution Jesus brings to the problems that humans have. Problems that husbands have, problems that wives, problems that children, problems at home, problems in the at job, problems if you are a leader, if you're a political leader, if you're a leader in the nation, you are facing a lot of problems. Doctors have problem, nurses have problem, teachers have problem. I saw a recent video where a teacher was so mad with the student and felt like he had disrespected her, I guess. She picked up a chair and they were in a fight because problems in the classroom, children against children, children against teachers, problems at home where some people don't speak to each other anymore. People come home and they're at each corner, husbands and wife and children and neighbors don't talk, and problems are going on, money problems, health problems. We are living in a nation right now, over 300 gangs in Jamaica. Is that okay with you? Are you okay with that? Are you okay with 300 gangs who are enslaving our young men into their service? Are you okay with that? Do you believe Jesus is okay with that? That's a big problem. That's a problem for not just the police. That's a problem for every believer. That should be a problem for every child of God. And we should do whatever we can to fix that problem. It can be fixed. I believe that God knows the solution to all our problems. One of the great work of the enemy, Satan, demonic spirit today, is to discourage people and to turn you and I from lifting up our eyes unto the hills from whence come our help. There are many, many substitutes that the enemy has raised up for you and I to look to for our help. Many, many problems and many, many substitutes. And what the enemy is trying to do is to overwhelm you with problems and then overwhelm you with alternatives so that you will not see Jesus. You know, the scripture tells us that if your eyes are dark, then your entire body is dark. If you are distracted, you cannot see the very answer that might be before you. God has been the solution. Jesus has been the answer. He has done it in many, many lives. He has done it in my life. You know, my parents, my mother was a single woman, and she looked to Jesus, and Jesus made a difference in her life. Jesus did made a difference in my life. But it's not just me. It's not about me. It's about whether or not Jesus truly can solve our problems. It's truly, I agree with John when he says the prophet has come into the world. I agree with the angels when they said glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill to men. I believe the gospel. I believe, my friends, that in spite of what the devil is doing, in spite of what governments or men and women or armies are doing, nobody will turn off the light on planet Earth until Jesus finishes his work, until God says so. Jesus is still the answer. Have you lost hope? If you've lost hope, my friend, you've been distracted. You're listening to too much news. You're watching too much social media. You are distracted with your cousin and your auntie and people you don't even know and people who don't even like you. You are all covered up with their opinion. Do you know what God is thinking? Do you know what God is saying? Are you one of those young people, one of those people, you have thrown aside the Bible? You stop going to church. You stop listening to gospel music. You stop reading the Bible. You stop praying. You say, well, when I was a boy, I used to do that. When I was a child, I did that. I'm a big man now. I have a job. I have a wife, or I have a girlfriend, or I have a boyfriend. I'm important. I have money. I don't need the church. I don't need the Bible. I don't need, you know, your grandmother. Some of you listening to me, your grandmother prayed you right off her knees. Huh? You were sitting on her knees, eating food off her lap, benefit from her table, that little church woman. Yes, the church woman who went to and prayed you to college, prayed you to university, prayed for you to get that job, prayed for you to move from country to Montego Bay. Hello? Huh? Pray that you move from country and come down to Mobay or go to Kingston and get a good tourist job. Now you get a good tourist job. Now you can travel. Now you have money. And now you have a pretty girl and or a nice handsome man. Now you have a nice house. And you don't want to pray no more. You don't think the Bible is important no more. You don't think the wisdom of God is relevant to you no more. The devil has lied to you and told you that it's something old people do. It's your grandmother thing. No, my friend, you are mistaken. You are mistaken. If you don't think you need oxygen, you go underneath the water and you stay there for a while. You'll find out you'll need an old-fashioned thing called oxygen. You need it. Yes, you do. I mean, you can ride on a fancy boat. You can have a snorkel. You can scuba dive. You can do all the fancy stuff you want to do. But guess what? You are not made to live underwater. You need oxygen. My friend, you are made spirit, soul, and body. You can beautify your body. You can build up your body muscle. Nowadays, everybody seems like they want to show off every single part of their body. Everybody needs to see everything about everybody. But you know what? You can show off your body all you want. You can be Miss Personality or Mr. Personality. The fact of the matter is, you're a spirit. You need a spiritual relationship. You need God. You need God. You say, well, Pastor Peter, I don't need God. But you know what? I want to quickly just tell you and show you some indications that you need God. Here's one. Do you find that in order for you to relax, you need an alcoholic drink? Have you found that more and more? In order for you to relax and just, you know, calm down, you need to either smoke a joint or smoke a ganja or take cocaine or some pills, or you need an alcoholic drink. Or do you find that in order for you to relax, you just need music, or you need to be with a man or be with a woman to be at peace? Do you find that? Well, that's an indication that you are looking for something. That's right. You are looking for something, because, you know, peace and joy and rest doesn't come externally. It comes from within. But when you don't have it within, you're looking for it. So you think you need a vacation, or you need a more fancy car, or you need a hotter lady, or you need a more, you know, handsome man, or you need a smoke some ganja, or you need to drink some ganja tea, or you need to eat some ganja biscuit or whatever. I mean, it's like all over the place nowadays, right? I mean, people are desperately looking for a spiritual experience through drugs. If you find yourself going after drugs, it's an indication that your spirit is saying to you, hello, hello, I'm here. Hello, don't forget me. Hello, hello, I need Jesus. I need God. I need to talk to God. I need the help of God. Some of you, you have given over your future to gangs, given over your hope for someone who is in immorality or in wrongs. You've given over your hope for the future to a political party. That political party is like your God. That political leader is like Jesus to you. You worship them. Oh, my friend, it's an indication that you need God. God knows the solution to our problems. And what I love about what is revealed to us in John chapter 6 is the fact that God cares for us. Hallelujah. God cares about us. And he doesn't care for us after we tell him the problem. He actually cares for us before we even bring the problem to him. Before we even articulate, before you shed a tear, before you cry out, before you call a pastor for prayer, before you come to church, before you say, Jesus, help me, before you cry out, he knows your prayer. He knows and he cares about you. In John chapter 6, we see a clear indication of this. Jesus, working all week, praying, doing a mass crusade, a lot of healing, a lot of miracles. He was basically going on a retreat. It's like going off to Holiday Inn or going down to the mall. He was going somewhere to just retreat at a resort, if you will. And the people came. The people found out that Jesus was staying down the road at Holiday Inn or down the road there at Sandals or some hotel. And the people barged into where Jesus was, so to speak, and says, we have some problems. And I love this. The Bible says, as Jesus lifted up his eyes and seen the great multitude who were coming towards him. I'm here to tell you that long before you even say one word, Jesus knows what's on your heart. He saw them coming to him and he started making preparation to solve their problem. He said to the disciples, where shall we buy bread that these may eat? I love the rest of this. It says, this he said to test them. You know, the word of God will test you. Sometimes when you hear preachers preach and men and women of God counsel you with the word of God, it's not because God doesn't know the answer. Many times it's not because they don't know the answer. Many times it's a question for you to find the answer, for you to be stirred up in your faith. It says Jesus asked them the question, and it went on to say, for he himself know what he would do. Come on, say that with me. He himself knew what he would do. There was a problem. The multitude needed food. Jesus knew what he would do. Oh, how many times we have come to Jesus almost, well, acting as if he don't have a clue what's going on. He doesn't have a clue that your children need food. He doesn't have a clue that there's a sickness to your body. And we act as if we are informing him about the problem, and we are catching him up on the problem we are having because, you know, he's so busy, he's got the entire world to take care of. I want to tell you that's not true, my friend. He knows the very number of hair upon your head, and some of us, where the hair keep going, he knows how to subtract. He knows everything about you. Jesus cares about you. The Bible says before He even asked them the question, he knew what he wanted to do. You know what's been on my heart recently? I've been looking, listening, and just looking at how Jesus operates. I look in Matthew when he tells us how to pray. And the Bible says we should not pray and just repeat prayers like the heathens do, because they think they will be heard by their much repetition. And the Lord began to say, to show me there in Matthew 6, that the Lord says, you know what? Before you even ask, I know what the problem is. That really has convicted me. Let me ask you a question. How do you think your prayer life would change if you really believed that God already knew the problem you're going to pray about, and that God already had an answer for the problem you're about to pray about? So you have a problem, right? You knew that God already knew about it, number one. And not only does he already know about it, he has already designed a solution for it. Hallelujah. Wouldn't that change the way you pray? Wouldn't that change even what you say? Wouldn't that change your approach to prayer? And I believe that's what the Lord is drawing us to today. I want you to know that there are many, many problems we're facing in Jamaica. Many problems at the national level. Many problems at the local level. And whether you're a leader or whatever in position you are, God bless you in your leadership. But it's important for you as a leader to understand that God already knows the problems of Jamaica. God already knows the problem of your community. You're a mother, you're a father, you're a businessman, you're an employer, an employee. In your own body, there is sickness or disease. You're listening to me even right now from the hospital. Or you might be in jail. God already knows what the problem is. The Bible tells us, and I love this, in Romans chapter 8. And I want you to listen to what the Lord says. The Lord didn't say there was not going to be some problem coming. The Lord didn't say there was not going to be obstacles. The Lord didn't say that the enemy was not going to try to do things against you and against me. But listen to the attitude of one who has a revelation that God already knows, and God has already prepared an answer. He already knows. He has already prepared an answer. Listen to the attitude. Listen to what Paul says. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, shall he not with him also freely give us all things? All. That includes any problem you and I are facing today. Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? That's you. If you have come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it is God who justifies you. Who is he who condemns? Condemns, shut you off, sentence you to that problem. You think you're sentenced to the problem. Yes, you have a diagnosis from the doctor. Yes, you lost your house. Yes, there's an argument. But who say that's the end of your world? Who says that's the end of your life? Who has condemned you? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who is making intercession for us. Come on, hallelujah. Who is going to condemn you when you have Jesus as your lawyer? Do you believe that? I believe that today. I believe that regardless of the problem I'm facing, Jesus is my intercessor. Jesus is working a solution out. Jesus doesn't just see in a linear way. He doesn't just see right what's in front of him. He sees what's in front of me, and he sees what's behind. He sees 360 degrees. Hallelujah. And he is my intercessor. Intercessor means person who goes between. So the one who goes between you and the problem and destruction, you and the problem and condemnation, you and the problem, and what of the enemy try, is Jesus. Stick with Jesus. Stick with the view of Jesus. Jesus saw the problem the multitude were having even before the multitude articulated it. And he had an answer. He had an answer. I'm going to go back to that in a minute. But let's continue reading in verse 35. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Who? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? You know, whatever your name is, Who shall separate you? Put your name in that. Who shall separate Peter Burnett from the love of Christ? Christ loves me. He loves me. He cares about me. He is attentive to my problems. And he's not just there saying, it's all right, boy, it's all right. No, no. He is crafting a solution. Amen? He is working. He is causing all things to work together. God has an answer, has a solution. He says, who shall separate us from the love of God? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? That's what we're going through. Many of us are facing that in our country today. Peril. Can't come out at night. Have to sleep inside barbed doors and barbed wire and all kind of things. Gun blaring or sword. As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate us. Don't let the enemy brainwash you and overwhelm you with the problem to the point that you think the problems have separated you from God. Your problems have not separated you from God. Your sickness is not an affront to God. And some people say, Pastor, I can't come to church. I'm sick. Well, God is not offended by your sickness. Your sickness doesn't make you a curse. Your problems don't make you a less of a person. Just because you're going through something doesn't make you worse than someone who has been through already. Nothing can separate you. The place that the enemy tries is to get you in your thinking and in your mind to think that your problems have created a wall between you and God. It's as if God says, well, now you have a problem, don't come to church too often. You know, now you have a problem, you stay over there, and I am God. I don't want you to give me a bad reputation. So don't say you're a Christian. You stay over there with your problem. And when you fix your problem, come back to church. Come back over here. No, that is a lie from the pit of hell. That is a deception the enemy wants to bring to you. The devil is trying to undermine God's love in your life because he wants to isolate you so he can destroy you. Do you hear what the Spirit of God is saying to you today? God loves you. He cares about you. And he has a solution to your problem. Quickly, let me show you how God operates. Miraculous. You see, the solutions that God have are supernatural. But the answer that people have are natural. We see in verse, when Jesus asked them, what are you going to do? They gave Jesus an answer in verse 7. As many of you, and I have to fight against this myself. Many times I face a problem, and the first thing I worry about is money. Do you have that problem too? You have that temptation? Whether or not you can solve the problem, you want to check your checkbook or how much money you have or who's going to give you something. Money. You want to count up the dollars. That's what Philip said. You know, hey, we have a big problem, big people to feed. How much money do you have, Judas? Oh, 200 denarii worth of bread. 200 denarii. Well, that's not enough money to buy the bread we need. It's a solution number one. That's a problem. And then another disciple, you know, they're having a board meeting. Another one says, Andrew, this is Simon Peter's brother. He says, well, actually, there's a young man down there with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. But what are they among so many? He said it, but then he undermined his own confession. You know, he said the solution. He said something God had provided. You see, you don't need the whole factory if all you need is a slice of bread. Yeah, I remember praying for a guy one time. He says, Pastor Peter, I'm going to come to church as soon as I make enough money from selling my shoes. And guess what? The devil heard that, and the devil made sure he never made enough money so he could come to church. He could stay there because he was thinking the money from selling shoes would be the solution that bring him closer to God. No, it's not. Many times the answers that God gives us is right around us. We look at money, or we look at whether or not we have resources. Do we have enough resources? But I want to tell you that whatever is in your hand is enough. Whatever you is in your hand. And there's one thing that we all have that we can use to receive the solution of God in our heart. You want to hear what it is? We all have it. That young boy had 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And that 2 fish, and when he gave them to the disciples, I want you to notice something. Notice that Jesus put them to sit down. See, if you have a problem, if you want God to work on it, you need to sit down. You do. Because if you're going to fix the problem, then what's the sense of God fixing it? So you need to sit down. Sit down and let God work for you. And so they sat down. That's, to me, that sitting down is like saying, go to church. Go to church. Be a part of a local church. And guess what? Jesus took the bread, gave it to the disciples, and the disciples gave it to those who were sitting down. Just by you taking the act of getting ready, bringing your family together, going to church, that's a statement of faith. That is an act of faith. Sit down. Let the Lord help you to solve your problems. And as they were sitting there, bread came. Just as you will sit in the church, you never know which word from God will help you to solve the problem. You never know, and you could be a leader in our city or in our nation. You sit under a pastor, you sit in a local church, you open your heart to the word of God. God will give you a solution to some of the most terrible problems you're dealing with. The bread of life will come. It will feed your soul. It will give you wisdom. But you got to be willing to sit down. You got to be willing to be fed by other disciples of Jesus. And the Bible says when it was all over, there's more left. There was more for others. So my question as we close this up is, what do you have in your hand? And what did they display that we could display that could also bring about solutions and the manifestation? And I really believe it's simple. It's faith. Faith. When you obey the words of Jesus, you are obeying, you're activating faith. And when you activate faith, supernatural answers come. Faith comes by hearing, the Bible says, in Romans chapter 10 and verse 17. Romans chapter 10, 17. Faith comes to us by hearing the word of God. And hearing the word of God. We keep hearing the word. We are enabled, we are empowered to obey that word. And it's in the obedience of the word, supernatural things happen. You didn't do it. Those disciples didn't multiply the fish and the bread. You see, there is a supernatural realm, a spiritual realm, because of their obedience. And so the natural became overpowered by the supernatural, and we saw the manifestation of the will of God. We saw the solution of God. Let me say it again. When we surrender the natural and we take steps of faith in obedience to the word of God, the natural things we do in obedience to what God says will trigger and meet up with the supernatural working of God, and then we have the favor of God. Then something miraculous happened. For example, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5 verse 17, if any man be in Christ, is a new creation. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. How does old things pass away? How does all things become new? How does a man, a rough man, a bad man, a mean man, a bad woman, how do they become new creation? Because they confess, they believe in their heart, they confess with their mouth the Lord Jesus Christ. And by them taking that step of faith in the natural, of believing and confessing, something supernatural met up with their natural action of obedience and supernatural result. He's changed. She's changed. God takes out the stony heart. He puts in a heart of flesh. God gives them the fruits of the spirit of love and joy and meekness. And they begin to change from the inside out. It's a supernatural work. People are transformed supernaturally. That's why, church, we are the answer for the gangsters. You are the answer for those in the rum bar. You are the answer for those that are sin. We, the Christians, we are the answer for the transformation of man. Because if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Anything can happen. The word became flesh. God can transform a man. It started from the very beginning. God said, let there be light. In Genesis chapter 1. And what happened? God spoke it. And immediately the Bible says the word went out. And the Holy Spirit took the word of God and brought forth into the natural that which God wanted to do. That's why we pray, Lord, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. How does the will of God become done on earth as it is in heaven? When we say what God's saying, we align ourselves with the word of God. We take steps of faith in obedience to the word of God. Sat down, distributed the food. While they were distributing the food, the natural entered into the supernatural realm. Hallelujah. We saw it over and over through the life of Jesus. You can see change and solution to any problem by the will of God. You want to know what the will of God. You want to know what the word says about that problem. You then need to stand on that word concerning that problem and expect the supernatural to meet you along the way. Hear what God says. Stand on what God says. Declare, I think it's also important, speak with your mouth what God says. Let there be some action. Faith is an active word in obedience to the word of God. And then you wait, you see, and God will bring the super on your natural. See, when the super matches your natural obedience, that's supernatural. This was actual bread, actual fish, actual disciples, actual grass they were sitting on, actual people eating actual food. But something spiritual happened. Because we are not alone in the fight. We are not isolated from God. God cares and God knows what he was going to do. Hallelujah. God already knew that he was going to multiply the fish. But he needed the boy to show up. He needed the people to sit down. He needed them to receive from one another. And then he would do his part. You see, there's some things that you're asking God to do. That God has said, I'm ready to do my part, but are you ready to do your part? God knows the solution to all our problems. I believe in prayer and fasting. I believe in tarrying. I believe in crying out to God. But if you cry out as if you're trying to tell God something he doesn't know, you are missing it. If you think that your prayer and fasting and your weeping and mourning is going to twist God's hand, or you think that you're going to give God $100,000 to make him bring you the solution you need. That's not how it works. He already knows. When you went to the ATM to pull the money out, he already knew what the problem was. And he already knew the solution. It's relationship. Father, I thank you today for those who are listening. We have a lot of problems. You know, God, you know. But you're not overwhelmed. You have not lost sight of hope and faith. I pray that faith will be stirred up in the heart of someone who's listening to this program and that they would once again look to you for the solution. They would lift up their eyes unto the hills from whence come their help. Lord, I pray that you will move in the heart of someone that they will say like Joshua, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I pray today, Lord, that someone will bow their knees and accept you as a Lord and Savior. I pray for those discouraged and backsliders and all of us with every problem. We will always remember that even before we ask, even before we tell you the problem, you already know what you would do. Oh Lord, I ask you to forgive us for the times we have insulted your intelligence. Forgive us for the times we have been prideful and cocky in your presence. Forgive us, God, when we try to manipulate and out-talk you and even sweet-talk you. Forgive us, Father. Give us a new heart and attitude towards you, knowing that you are our Father who cares for us. And I pray you will show yourself strong. Glorify your name, O God. Glorify your name in the earth. Glorify your name in Jamaica. Glorify your name across St. James. Glorify your name in the different areas in our cities surrounded by hurt and men and women surrounded by crime and surrounded by lions and sharks and Lord and swords that are drawn. Show yourself like you did with Daniel in the midst of the lion den. Show yourself strong for those who call upon you. Lord, I believe in you for awesome testimonies, for the glory and the praise of your name. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. God bless you today. Jesus knows the solution for our problems. I'm about to close off, and I want to thank all of you for joining me on the Time of Reflection today here on Faith Broadcasting Network. As you can see, the phone numbers are on the screen. You can call 24/7, and if you don't get someone when you call, leave a message, and someone will call you back. You have a prayer request? Go ahead and leave it there. You can share what problems you want us to stand with you about. God already knows what they are. We want to come alongside with you to receive from God those solutions and to pray for you that your faith will be strong to receive from God and you will have clarity for the word of God as well. And I want to tell you about the ministry that I also lead, which is Emmanuel Caribbean University. The purpose of our ministry is teaching. Our vision is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. God has really given us a mandate to help to raise up leaders in Jamaica and in the Caribbean. And I believe there's a need for thousands of people to be raised up to serve God as pastors and all kinds of servants within the church. But I believe there's also a need for thousands of believers to be equipped to serve God in education, in business, and in all areas of society, to be the salt that God has called us to be. If you're interested in knowing more about our school, whether it's our diploma, or just to take one course, or go to our bachelor's program, just give us a check out our website, rather, ecujamaica.com, ecujamaica.com. We'd love to hear from you. You can send us a question, go to contact us, send us your invitation or your information, and we will reach out to you. Amen. God bless you so much. We're going to be together again next week. We'll continue to study the Word of God. And remember, God is working. God knows your problem before you call. He is ready to answer. And we pray that you will get back in love with the Word of God. God bless you. Have a great time in His presence. Bye-bye.
Every time I read my Bible, feel alright, alright. Every time I read my Bible, feel so nice, man. Every time I read my Bible, I get a little knowledge, yes I do. Every time I read my Bible, I get to know Jesus Christ. Yes, every time I read my Bible, feel alright, alright. Yeah.
kingdom of God and all his righteousness, then all other things shall be added unto you.
Every time I read my Bible, I feel alright.
Where can young people cleanse their ways? It's only by taking heed to the word of God. For the word of God is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Man, every time I read my Bible, I get a little knowledge. Every time I read my Bible, I get to know Jesus Christ.
Despitefully use you and persecute you, that he may be children of your Father which is in heaven.
Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the